welkom bij Energy Transition Thursday vanuit Circle, de maandelijkse talkshow waarbij we duurzame vernieuwingen op de snijtafel leggen.
We hebben nog een vraag uit de chat of het publiek.
Als ik droom, zou ik zeggen dat zou echt de warmtetransitie kunnen versnellen.
Welcome back to Energy Transition Thursday. Today we're going to discuss the opportunities and challenges of fuel cells in the energy transition for scale-up. Fuel cells can transform hydrogen into electricity for a range of applications, including mobility sector, as well as industry and electricity sector. And as always at Energy Transition Thursday, we dissect a sustainable earnings model, in this case fuel cells, with four experts at the table. And we, of course, invite you to join in into this discussion by asking questions via the chat. And I'll try to insert them in the conversation we have. The four experts at the table tonight are... Tonight, it's not tonight yet. During this afternoon, is first of all on my right hand side the engineer Lennart van den Burg from TNO. Welcome. Thanks. Lennart is business development manager renewable hydrogen at TNO and involved in more than 50 hydrogen projects. The projects range from hydrogen production through the chain up to usage of hydrogen in industry and mobility. So a lot of experience there already. Again, welcome. Second expert at the table tonight is a manufacturer of fuel cells, Roel van der Pas from Netstack. Welcome. Roel is commercial director at Netstack and board member at the Dutch Hydrogen and Fuel Cell Association, the NWBA, the NWBA. It's more fluid in Dutch, but it's a Dutch association, yeah. So that's fitting. Welcome as well. The third expert at the table is the operator, so the investor, the user of the fuel cell, Marion Kasteleins from Future Proof Shipping. Marion is business development manager at Future Proof Shipping, which was founded in 2017 to accelerate the transition to zero emission shipping by developing their own fleet of zero emission vessels and by supporting other ship owners and partners to sail zero emission. And this is not just an ambition, they will have the first true zero emission cargo vessel sailing on hydrogen and fuel cells by the end of 2021, so the end of this year. I'd love to hear more about that later in this hour. Welcome. And finally, the banker at the table, Arthur van Dijk from ABN AMRO. Welcome.
Thank you.
Arthur is a managing director with 20 years of experience in equity capital markets. He worked as the head of equity capital markets for one of the largest renewable energy banks in the world, Macquarie Capital, and he was responsible for attracting capital for a lot of infrastructure and clean energy sectors in Asia and Europe, and also guided a lot of companies through the IPO process to become listed. Welcome. Exciting panel for tonight, but let's dive into one of the, I think, most fundamental questions we could start with, Lennart. What is a fuel cell?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think probably most of the audience probably know what a fuel cell is, but the basic description is you do compressed hydrogen. You see it in a picture on the anode side. There, the magic actually take place. It's reacting with the oxygen coming from the air. And there, on one side, you've got the electricity, which is going into electromotor. On the other side, yeah, we've got pure water, which is going in outside, with no emission. And that's the whole reason why a fuel cell is a key enabling technology, because it's the production itself, there's no emission. And that's why it's so important to have this technology.
Yeah. So you need hydrogen and oxygen, they go in, yeah, and out come water and electricity that can be used, yeah, for, yeah, many applications.
Key applications. I mean, a lot of people know it from the personal car, but to be honest, especially in the Netherlands, we've got now 300,000 electric cars and only 300 fuel cell cars. So personal vehicles, the numbers worldwide will be high, but for the Netherlands, it's limited. We mainly see fuel cells where a lot of heavy weights, long distances are needed for trucks, shipping. That's important, but also for power production. That's important, and also for I call it yellow vehicles. Yeah. So on the building sites where we are
for the built environment,
build
the heavy environment, trucks,
heavy trucks,
and lifting.
Yeah, that's really important. And the picture you see here, I mean, there's one cell. A fuel cell is based on a number of cells. So they are really small, so they're stacked up on each other. So the fuel cells are stacked number of cells stacked on each other.
Okay. Yeah. So this is just one. They're stacked and then used in many different portable, stationary mobility, which we'll dive into more later on as well. I have to address this immediately as well. You could also reverse the process, right?
Yeah.
And basically have electrolysis.
Yeah.
So electricity going in, hydrogen coming out. Is that just switching the plug?
There's one technology, the solid oxide, which actually the solid oxide can be, do both ways. So that's really the reversal. So in one. Technology. You put hydrogen in, but the other also you can put electricity and producing hydrogen. So there's one in one appliance, let's say. You see basically dedicated technology. So one producing electrolysis, and the other and another technology is you're really using the making the hydrogen to produce electricity.
So generally speaking, you should really discuss
that
them
really
separately.
But I mean, they're obviously. I mean, we will talk today later. I mean, we're really important because you need green hydrogen. You need to produce green hydrogen. In order to reach those zero emission, so that's really important.
Or blue when it's captured.
You have to do two colors. With green hydrogen produced with wind and solar. With electrolysis, we've got the hydrogen and it can use in a fuel cell. We could also use methane, which is actually most of the hydrogen produced in the Netherlands. After Germany, the Netherlands is one of the highest producers of hydrogen, but also one of the current hydrogen production really is a large emitter of CO2.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the options is that you capture the CO2 at the pipe, transport and store it underground. And then you've got blue hydrogen, which emission of only 10%, depending on the capture rate.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so to summarize, hydrogen goes in. You have the gray hydrogen, which is just where CO2 is emitted by burning or using methane or natural gas.
Or even coal. Coal is also used.
Coal.
Yeah.
Then you have blue hydrogen, where the same process used, but the CO2 is captured and stored underground. We have a separate episode, also in English, of an hour, where you can find it on YouTube if you want to know more about CCS. Yeah. And then third, through electrolysis, you can produce it with green electricity, right?
Yeah.
And the latter two or the last one is fully emissions free.
If we use renewable electricity, that's important.
Very fundamental thing there. Let's throw in a poll question as well for the audience. We must strive for full adoption of the potential for fuel cell technology, even if it requires using gray hydrogen in the meantime, as long as gray hydrogen, maybe blue hydrogen, is not available. Agree or disagree? You can react now. I'm interested to hear your response. Let's go to Roel. There was a short introduction of what fuel cells are and what their role is in the system. But Netstek has been a producer since the 90s already, right? This is not...
As an independent company since the 90s, Before that, we were part of Akzo Nobel Group, and there were already fuel cells produced from before that time from another mother company, which was ECN, currently a part of TNO.
Yeah.
But since late 90s, Netstek is an independent company focusing at the manufacturing of PEM fuel cells.
And you were already looking at the same applications what we are looking at now for fuel cells? Or how did it... Because that's early, right?
We're a bit of a strange fuel cell maker, if you like. Netstek has always focused at what we call high-power, high-use applications. There were actually two reasons why Akzo was so interested in building fuel cells. First of all, because they were a big supplier of coatings, polymers, composites, all of these fundamental chemical building blocks of fuel cells were available within the larger Akzo Nobel group.
Yeah.
But secondly, as Lennart already explained, the Netherlands is a big producer of hydrogen, and most of that hydrogen is a byproduct of industrial processes, most importantly, the production of chlorine.
Yeah.
And Akzo is a big producer of chlorine. For every 35 tons of chlorine you produce, there is a ton of hydrogen as a byproduct.
Extra.
Now, you can flare that and send the heat and the NOx to the angels, or you can capture that and bring the heat to the brine and bring the electricity to your electrolysis plant and make sure that you can reduce the cost and you can reduce the emissions of a chlorine site. So they had both ends of the supply chain, the fundamental building blocks, and they had a lot of hydrogen that they could use that was a waste.
And ECN around the corner?
had the application expertise of building PEM fuel cell systems, testing them, and had a lot of expertise at the state of the art of those technologies. So yeah. That was a happy wedding. It were both Dutch companies, so Netstek. This is how Netstek was born. The reason why I explain that is that the signature technology that you need to use an industrial off-gas to convert that in a very safety-critical environment for very long periods of time is fundamentally different than most of the dominant PEM fuel cell applications in forklifts, passenger cars, portable devices, domestic appliances. You need something for a different technology signature. Yeah. High power, high use requires optimization for lifetime and for what we call levelized cost of energy.
That's a lot of difficult jargon. What do you mean with that?
The price per kilowatt hour is what matters instead of the price per kilowatt. You want something that lasts a long time and that is very efficient and very safe.
Yeah.
And you end up with something which is maybe not so beautiful and maybe not so compact, but does what you need to do.
Because if you what you don't build is the fuel cells for cars that require to be also very safe and very durable, etc.
Yeah, but within a different regulatory framework. Yeah. And of course, they need to be durable. But if you would accumulate the amount of running hours of a passenger car engine, especially a passenger car fuel cell engine, a few thousand hours is sufficient. When you build a PEM power plant for stationary applications, you want it to last 20 years.
Yeah.
And maybe run over 8,000 running hours per year.
Yeah, so that is car is idle 95% of the time. And for these many industrial applications, it's full-time running, right?
Yeah, so until recently, actually, industry was our main market.
Yeah.
And almost our only market. But what we see now that this signature of high power, high use is popping up in many places as hydrogen becomes available. The maritime industry is an industry of interest today. So in the maritime space, you want 5-year dry dock periods. Yeah. You want a power plant that can be in a vessel for 20 years. And maybe if it's a bit less power dense, you don't care so much. It's about efficiency.
Yeah.
Around the clock renewables, so buffering non-grid adaptable solar or wind energy, that is a business model that becomes attractive and starts to become close to a break-even point in some parts of the world.
Yeah.
So these are the type of applications where our signature technology makes sense and where our portfolio is commercialized.
So maybe in the volume of fuel cells you produce, there are probably those that deliver supply to the automobile industry that deliver much higher quantities of fuel cells, but you really produce maybe the bigger industrial high-use,
So this is definitely where we try to differentiate. Yeah. Netstek is a market leader on high-power, high-use PEM solutions. We've built the world's longest-running PEM power plant. We were the first in the world to build those units at the megawatt, and also the largest PEM power plant in the world is built by Netstek. That is our market.
Your market. I already mentioned it last week on LinkedIn. We have a world leader within the Dutch borders in that segment for fuel cells. I go to Marion. Future-proof shipping, I mentioned in the introduction, is building its own fleet, or at least this year, the first fully emission-free vessel.
Yeah.
Can you tell us more about where we are and what you're doing?
Yeah, so what we are a company set up really to, in the end, to be a company, so also to be a business, right?
Yeah.
So it's not because some people think if we say we work on the acceleration of energy transition, they think we are some kind of foundation or so, but we're not. But the aim is really, the purpose is really to accelerate the energy transition in shipping to zero emission, so purely zero emission. We don't work on transition solutions like
LNG,
biofuels maybe, and these kind of things, or filters, but we really only focus on solutions that are truly zero emissions. And currently, if you look at vessels or ships, you can sail zero emission, truly zero emission, in two ways. Yep. It's always electric, and then you can do it with a battery or with a fuel cell. And the battery is only applicable to certain segments, so typically used in ferries currently and some smaller vessels.
Small distance.
Some inland vessels could also use batteries, but it's really on specific routes, let's say. But we really believe that if we go ahead towards longer routes, larger vessels, and then moving away from inland shipping to short sea and then deep sea, fuel cells and hydrogen, any type of hydrogen carrier, which is still a big debate, will be the solution.
Yeah. we also see it in the picture in the screen.
Yeah.
So battery electric vehicles for passenger cars. And up in the top right, you see, shipping in the league of air travel as well. And heavy trucks somewhere in the middle.
Yeah.
It's, as you mentioned, a mixed bag of applications. And there is not one type of ship, but many different
exactly.
routes and applications.
Yeah.
But generally speaking, fuel cells would be one of the key
yeah.
go-to solutions.
Yeah, that's
to go zero
yeah.
emission.
Yeah.
And this, you're retrofitting a ship now, right?
Yes.
MASS.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So last year, January, we bought this vessel. It's a second hand, let's say, or third hand even.
Yeah.
So it's an existing vessel, over 20 years old. But typically, inland vessels last for 60, 70, 80 years. So it's not an old vessel, let's say. 110 meters length. And we see it on the screen. And there she is. So currently she's sailing from Rotterdam to an inland port or terminal in Belgium.
As we speak.
Every day or three times a week, more or less, she makes a return trip. And still running on diesel right now. But by the end of the year, we are planning to complete a retrofit, basically removing the internal combustion engine
yeah.
and all the propulsion that is related to it,
yeah.
all the energy systems. And then we will place, everything you see here. So a large, electric engine. So
yeah.
We electrify the vessel. We have a large battery system on board. Two, actually, one for the bow thruster, which is in front of the vessel, and then one for the electric propulsion. And then there's going to be a significant fuel cell system on board, just below 1 megawatt. And then, of course, yeah, there's a whole integration of all these elements. It's
yep.
also a big segment, which is not, you can't really show on the vessel, but
yep.
it's a big element.
Okay.
And the energy or the hydrogen will be carried in swappable containers at 300 bar. So it's a compressed hydrogen.
That's a complex, complex operation to retrofit an existing ship, I can
yeah.
imagine.
Yeah.
But very cool to see that, this is the first one coming. And then later on, probably more?
We are planning to do at least 5 by 2025. So 5 vessels. And there's also other parties that also have plans, but they're doing mostly new builds. And we are specifically
doing
retrofit.
5 should be the start of things, of course,
yeah,
if
exactly.
we want to meet climate ambitions. And
exactly.
otherwise, judges will hunt us, probably, as we learned yesterday. I go to Arthur, the banker at the table. You're a different type of banker than we have had previously at the table that did lending.
Yeah.
Can you explain what you do?
Sure, yeah. So thank you. Thanks for the introduction. So my focus is really on the equity product. And for we work a lot with companies, corporates throughout the energy transition thematic, but obviously also specifically in the case of fuel cells, looking to raise equity, so permanent capital, into their vehicle and then use that as a way to typically it's used to facilitate growth or to further develop existing R&D plans, et cetera, but to really drive the technology that sits within the company and then hopefully at some point also make it scalable so that you can actually also start applying it in commercial opportunities
yep.
Like we had just now.
So really attracting shareholder capital
yep.
From
Absolutely.
Different types of investors to scale.
Yeah, and it's quite interesting yeah. because that investor group has actually grown fairly materially over the course of the last few years.
Yep.
And I think where there has in the past been a very clear group, a focus from investors onto renewable energy, wind parks, solar parks, et cetera. They were sort of the low-hanging fruits within the energy transition thematic. We have seen investors increasingly move along, I would say, the risk curve as they look for the returns. And then you really delve into the specific niches within that.
Yeah.
And one of the things we're seeing is that fuel cells is actually one of the fastest growing sectors, subsectors within that transition thematic that that investors are trying to step into.
Because if we look at the screen again, you see here, this is a picture from
yeah.
TNO, I think, Lennart. A huge growth of the fuel cell market projected. If we want to meet 1.5 degrees?
Yeah, actually, it's in the graph from IEA. And on the left, you see the electrolyzers, which actually producing the green hydrogen. And there you see now, I mean, looking at the electrolyzer, the market is 200 megawatts. So virtually, it's really at the beginning. I was saying it's 20 years behind where solar is now. So that's electrolyzer technology. If you go to the other graph, that's the fuel cells, and you see now last year we broke to the 1 gigawatt barrier.
Yep.
So 1 gigawatt worldwide is installed every year, but if we really want to reach the 1.5 degrees warming up, or at least stay under it, that's the objective. Then this graph is saying, this the yellow one is saying we going in 2050. Up to 18,000 gigawatts.
Yep.
18,000. I mean, I think we can't believe these numbers. So that's really.
Rule is going to work overtime.
Yeah, I mean, it's incredible because the industry is not there yet. So there's much more efforts needed to actually scale it up.
Okay, cool. Yeah. And you're saying investors
and I'm saying
are seeing this.
Investors are seeing this and they're realizing the opportunity. And it's actually going hand in hand with corporates who are developing the technology, such as NetStack, for example, and others that are looking for capital, and we're actually trying to bring those two pools together.
Yeah.
I think, as you highlight here, the exponential growth that we can see presents a tremendous opportunity. I think at the same time, it's also a challenge for investors to actually identify which companies will be the ones that will actually be at the forefront of that technology as it continues to develop over the next few years.
And what do you look at? Because you probably advise those people. Yeah, who are the winners?
Well, we do. And I think it's a very interesting dynamic because what we see is there are a number of factors that you can typically look at. I think what we typically look at is the scalability of the product, right? How easily is it to actually scale up the product? Yeah. How unique is actually the technology that's in there? Obviously, a fuel cell is a fuel cell, but the way to apply it it can be materially different. And then there are a number of other factors, such as the submarkets they're in. We spoke a little bit about the mobility challenges, where the fuel cell sector fits. And lastly, also, of course, we look at the management team, and quite often there's a lot of passion within the management team, the engineers or people who have been involved in the sector for a long time, and it's great to work with them and help them realize their targets as they look to grow.
It's interesting you mentioned that you look for passion. Right? Not the hard financials, but you want to see passion in the eyes of the management.
Yeah,
you want to
see that because the investors that invest also want to know that they're buying into that management team.
Yeah.
And I think to the point where, and this is also a challenge, I think a lot of these companies may not have the financials to meet the requirements to be listed on a stock exchange, for example.
Yeah.
So we're seeing a lot also of pre-IPO financing, private round financings. We have three mandates at the moment. Across Europe, where we are looking for pre-IPO financing for these kind of companies. And at some point, we envisage these companies will either go public through a listing, or the other route that we're seeing quite often now is through a SPAC, which is a lot of SPACs are coming to Europe, and that's providing a different pool of capital.
A SPAC, I think about meat. What is a SPAC?
A SPAC is a special purpose acquisition company. So it's a blank check company that gets listed on the stock exchange, and then they try and look for targets. They try and find opportunities.
They first raise capital and then look for...
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And it goes quite well in hand because quite often companies that are fast growing would benefit from a pool of capital like that. And then all of a sudden, the product that's already there becomes scalable.
So do you see passion in the eyes of Roel when he's talking?
Absolutely, a firm commitment. He's been leading the charge for over 20 years.
So the market is bound to grow. We saw in the graph, Arthur mentioning a lot of willingness to step in from investors. Do you see the same dynamic?
Oh, absolutely.
What's the competitive landscape?
100%, 100%. So I'm not so long with NetStack. My first projects with NetStack were in 2006, 2007, I believe, when I was in a different life and a different function. But I'm with NetStack as an employee now for 4 years. And what I've seen since those 4 years, how not just the company, but the whole industry changed, it's dramatic. Yeah. We see the clients that we have, that we are serving now, are big industrial companies with series production plans, with the demands and the requirements that go with supplying to such players. And at the same end, we see, of course, a lot of new entrants. We see a lot of consolidation, acquisitions in the market. So there is a lot happening, and this landscape is changing very fast.
But I heard you mention you have quite a unique position in the niches where you're
active. Oh, absolutely.
So that's a plus. Okay. I mentioned earlier the poll question. What was your position on the use of green hydrogen? Should we wait for availability of green hydrogen?
As long as it's coordinated. There's always this game of supply-demand deadlocks. So it doesn't matter if either supply or demand is two steps ahead. As long as the policy itself is arranged to make sure that they come together at one point. Ultimately, the role of hydrogen is to provide something that enables this net zero transition, what we were talking about. So as long as that goal will be met in due time and there is balance between those policies, it's perfectly fine that either there is too much green hydrogen that is used in maybe not the most beautiful way by burning it, or there is a lack of green hydrogen, a surplus of grey hydrogen, but then an overkill of maybe fuel cell power systems that work on a zero emission
basis.
Keep
our eyes on the long-term goal and take some short-term effects for granted.
Yeah, either on the supply or the demand side, you can never be in perfect balance. And we shouldn't relax the pace of the slows.
I basically conclude that you were for option A. You agreed with the statement.
Yeah.
42.3% of people watching also did. So there's, I hope, maybe your pitch convinced a few. We won't ask the question again, but...
Vote again.
Yeah. Keep our eyes on the long-term goal, guys. Okay. Lennart, also a question from the audience. Can you clarify the difference in efficiency between fuel cells and internal combustion engines, both using either hydrogen or ammonia as a fuel?
Yeah.
Why
not burn it instead of using a fuel cell, you mean? Yeah, I mean a fuel cell is in that sense efficient because it's... I think one remark, we should not look at the vehicle itself, but we should look at the full food chain. So the production hydrogen, then it comes to the refueling station. I'm always using a personal car as an example, but maybe it's not the best example, but for efficient people, so you produce hydrogen, refueling station, you tank it, and then you use it in a fuel cell, and then typical efficiency is like 50% something. You have the hydrogen you can use in for electricity. Looking at a combustion, I don't know, Roel, what's your view on that? I don't have the numbers by hand if you compare it to combustion.
Combustion of hydrogen or combustion of diesel?
Yeah, of ammonia, you're saying.
So the Carnot principles apply, so it depends on whether it's on its sweet spot. Actually, I hear that hydrogen combustion gensets, from an efficiency perspective, aren't that far away, 5% points, something in that order of magnitude from fuel cell power conversion. But keep in mind that in burning hydrogen, there are other things in the air that also react. So also the nitrogen will produce NOXs and so on. The idea was this net zero transition, right? So this zero emission should be at least in our thinking.
So it's an SOX. Shipping is very well used to discussions about any type of emissions. And probably they will sit next to each other, right?
There will
in
be
the energy system. There will be burning in
gas-fired
power stations, maybe, that are already...
Yeah, in shipping, it's considered also a transition solution in a way. So most people now agree that it's going to be a transition solution to possibly also use a combustion engine for hydrogen or ammonia or...
Until they do a retrofit.
Competitive, people are ready to make the shift towards electric, etc. Because that's also also a mindset, and it's a change in mindset. People are used to have a combustion engine.
But you mentioned you're really focusing on the net zero the completely zero emission solutions. A lot of talk over the past few years has been on the application of LNG in the shipping sector. Do you see that as a reasonable stepping stone towards the final emission-free alternative?
I understand that some parties in the sector still prefer to use LNG as an in-between, as a transition. Personally, I think LNG. Well, in maritime sector, it has taken a very long time to develop LNG, and it's actually taken too long. So, especially for example in inland shipping, some people invested in LNG vessels with a certain business case, and when it actually came to market, the business case deteriorated, and now these vessels are basically well, running at a loss almost, yeah. Right? So, and of course that can change again with fuel, fossil fuel prices changing, etc. But still, it's so it kind of came too late, let's yeah. say. So it doesn't mean that nobody should now be sailing on LNG, but I would rather see everybody focusing, you know,
if
on the next.
If you're building up big infrastructure towards 2050, let's not do it twice.
Please, let's skip this one. Yeah. And there's also a lot of emission discussion, right?
I think see strong agreement on the other end of the table.
Yeah, no, 100%. Yeah. So I think LNG was perfectly fit for the policy environment we had, which was very strongly about air quality. But when we look at it from a carbon perspective, it's not better. It's not better than sailing on diesel. And if we are pursuing a route, which we know will end, maybe not even in the long run, but in the mid-run, we're actually building stranded assets. And we will build also bad experiences in an energy transition. We shouldn't do that. You were talking about vessels earlier, the lifetime of vessels of 70 years. You cannot imagine that we are building or now building new vessels that will be kind of a victim of the energy transition, right?
Yeah, there are also some
dinosaurs when they're born.
But there are now some that start electrifying the vessel, so they build an electric vessel and then use generator or, you know, an energy combustion, which will then be, which is built in a modular manner so that later on it can be replaced with whatever will be the solution
keeping
at that point in time.
Keeping the options open. Yeah.
So, and that's maybe, you know, so for me, I always say the first step is electrification. That's it. Okay. Let's not do any combustion engines.
I think I have a question for Roel. This could be a question from a ship owner as well. What is the current maximum output of a fuel cell today for marine use, and what is the expected maximum output available in 5 years?
The largest projects we're pitching on are in the order of magnitude of 20 megawatt. So that is the largest what you can buy today. And I know we are bidding on those projects in competition. So I'm quite sure there are others who also are confident on meeting those power ranges. Anything above that with current production capacity and with current supply chain pressure will be a multi-year project. Likely it's going to be a multi-year project. But in theory, there is no limitation in stacking them. They're, as a battery system, it could be infinitely large as long as you work with a power conversion system that can work with that.
And if you have enough space on board or on deck, then you can make it big.
Yeah, of course. Well, space is a factor because no matter how beautiful hydrogen is as a fuel and how energy dense it is from a weight perspective, from a volume perspective, it doesn't match anything close to the dinosaur blood. I mean, diesel is, in that respect, still 4 times more power dense than even liquid hydrogen.
Yeah. Dinosaur so blood. Yeah. Remember that when you're at the fueling station.
I think that's an important remark because we should stop compare. Green hydrogen or any other clean fuel compared to the fossil fuels, because nothing can compete against fossil fuels. I mean, you should compare hydrogen to the other best option, direct electrification, ammonia, what you name it, but that's important. And so that's why policy and the emission, up to zero emission for vehicles, I mean, that should be the main driver.
Yeah.
After the renewable energy directive we have now on hand.
Compare zero emissions alternatives with each other and not with the dinosaur alternative.
Well, this is an important point what Leonard is making, and we could also see that in the graphs that we looked at before with the yellow and the orange bars.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The two scenarios, the only difference between those two scenarios is either something that follows the policy instruments as we have them in place today, which is the small orange bars, and the big yellow ones. If we indeed align our policies with the climate agreement goals that we've set on this 1.5 degrees centigrade.
Because I guess, Arthur, you mentioned there is this big market potential, but we see here, indeed, as Roel mentioned, two different scenarios playing out. I guess this is the risk that investors are taking. Instead of putting their money on proven wind solar projects with a low return, what is driving, in from your perspective, the risks?
Well,
I think the scenario.
Yeah, so I think it's quite interesting because under either scenario, you actually see really strong growth of the potential, and then the question really is, what kind of technology or subset of the fuel cell technology is the one that's ultimately going to be the winner? We just spoke a little bit about, you know, this sort of in-between step, potentially the LNG or other factors, but even within fuel cells, there's actually quite a broad cross-section of opportunities. So the question is, what investors are asking is, how can I identify the winner at this point for the next 5 or the next 10 years? Because that is ultimately where they want to be. The interesting thing is that even in the worst-case scenario, the potential opportunity is still very, very strong.
Yeah, because we can easily be distracted by the scale of the graph.
Exactly.
From where we are at, 2020 is hardly visible. Yeah.
It's barely visible, and even under the orange scenario.
In 2020, both fuel cells and electrolyzers, I was saying 200 megawatt. That's really nothing. We're talking about this one project in the Port of Rotterdam, which is now being developed, and fuel cells and 1 gigawatt. It's going to grow 10,000.
But we probably also another curve not shown here, technological learning curve.
Yeah.
We've seen it for batteries as well.
Yeah.
Smaller. Yeah. More lightweight, cheaper,
series
production instead of manual construction. Is that a learning curve we still have to go through?
And you look at all fuel cell technology, the focus is on what you're saying, smaller, more efficient, higher energy density, more fuel cells up to each other. You see a price range. If the most efficient is solid oxide electrolyzer, but that's still low TRL, so still in development, and that's now at, let's say, 1,000 euro a kilowatt and going up to... Going into the 2030, we go to 3,000 euro a kilowatt stationary. If we go to stationary PEM cells now at, let's say, 3,000 euro a kilowatt and going to maybe 500 euro a kilowatt. If you go to the automotive, there we're really low. We're now at 200 euro a kilowatt and maybe going to 50 euro a kilowatt.
We're already further down the learning curve.
Because the numbers are much higher.
And you mentioned low TRL, maybe 1, 2, 3. That means lab stage, demo stage.
Demonstration. Let's say TRL 4, 5, the improvements.
Not ready for commercial application.
Yeah.
Those, yeah. Or Roel, do you also see, how is a fuel cell currently constructed? Where are you towards series production and this learning curve effect basically?
Yeah, right now our output is about 10 megawatts per year. That is the rate at which we are running today.
Yeah.
Also, 10 megawatts on fuel cell power output per year, and that is our heartbeat. That is based on. Mostly manual assembly. Of course, there are a few critical steps where we have a higher degree of automation, but that wasn't initially intended for enabling higher volumes, but enabling higher precision.
Yeah.
If we look at the plans that we are planning now and that we have under application for some grants, that we are talking about gigawatt scale, we are talking about a heartbeat of 1 hertz, so 1 cell per second. That is the order of magnitude for which, to my knowledge, most of the BEM fuel cell players are planning.
Yeah.
And that is also at the speed at which the market is developing.
Yeah.
So we are absolutely witnessing a revolution in going from, 4 stacks a day in that order of magnitude to semi-automated production systems, which are derivatives also of how the battery production has developed over time. In that industry also, it started as a manual process. And most of the production system planning work we do today is benchmarking proven assembly families, assembly technologies from the battery industry, and applying that to how you produce a fuel cell.
Yeah. Okay, but standardization is a big chunk of making those steps, I guess. So we have the first emission-free vessel from Marion. The market can drive standardization by applying and moving towards a. But how are those standards set? Or do you, as a manufacturer, do you just decide for the market, this is going to be it? This is our pathway forward.
Yeah, there's different layers of standards, obviously. Fuel cells have been around since the 50s in the last century, so they aren't that new. If we look at it from a safety perspective, an installation perspective, and a functional perspective, the IEC has published a whole family of standards on PEM fuel cell systems. Those apply today and have always applied. All of the models that we build subscribe to those standards, are routine tested, and also have their type tests according to those standards. But today we're in a different era where customers require standardization, like in the battery days when AAA standards were developed. There is an initiative which is funded under the European Commission. It's called STASH. It's standardization, and I'm not so good with those acronyms, right? But it's a standardization initiative which pursues the same concept of modularity and integration, flexibility. And this is not just a European initiative. Players like Toyota and also the American leaders are participating in this in
order to develop. And they will probably have to conform to it if they want to sell on the European market as well, right?
It's not an initiative which is going to end up in legislation. At least that is not the intention. But the intention is due to the natural process of reducing the risk and the application complexity for the clients, that it's a natural process of adopting it. So an industry standard, if you like.
Yeah, because that will, if that happens, what we all discussed, costs could come dramatically down. What is the current cost multiple or cost increase you're looking at? Because I assume it's a little bit more expensive than conventional systems for shipping.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, so if you look at an inland vessel, you have a multiple, so it's like 3-4 times more expensive.
Yeah.
However, it's not just a fuel cell, right? So because that's what you just said earlier too. It's we have a fuel cell, but you also need to feed that fuel cell, and that electricity that comes out also needs to go somewhere. So it's the storage, the distribution system, and everything around it that also makes it still right now more costly. So it's a multiple. So it's far more expensive than just running on a.
You mean the complete transport operation?
Yeah, that too.
Okay. Yeah. But if I was transporting glasses, how would the impact the price of a glass? I mean, if we look at transport as a function of the total goods price, it's...
No, yeah, so the question was how much more expensive is a fuel cell compared to a combustion engine? If you look at the client, so the final client, we calculated for a box of shoes, it would literally be like 1 cent more expensive.
So it's
in shipping from
it can easily
on the
paid
inland
for.
Shipping part.
Yeah.
So it could easily be paid for. The customer is not going to notice it. Yeah. But if you look at how many boxes of shoes or how many televisions or laptops, whatever that cargo owner is transporting, then in the end they're going to pay. Well, 500,000 to 1 million euros a year extra filling a full vessel. So that's,
you have to match the willingness of the end consumer to pay more with the cost incurred by a ship owner.
And that is still very complicated.
So, and there is sort of a chicken and egg discussion in the sector permanently, I think. I mean, you're not going to buy a ship if you need hydrogen and you can't. There is no bunkering, no refueling. Yeah. There are no refueling stations. And the other way around, there will be no refueling stations if there are no fuel cell powered, hydrogen powered ships.
Yeah.
How do you break that cycle? What do you do?
Yeah, this is why we decided to fill containers with hydrogen, which can be basically filled anywhere at a filling point at the factory, basically.
Can be easily transported?
Can be transported. It's a 20-foot or 40-foot container and can be transported to a terminal where containers are being handled. It cannot be any standard container terminal. They should have a license to already move dangerous goods, but there are plenty available. And on those locations, we can then move the containers with hydrogen on the vessel, basically. So we empty the containers and then we swap them. They go to the filling station, and next time we pass by, to make it sound a bit simple, we fill it again. So of course there's quite some logistics behind it to make sure that that's also done efficiently, and there's also costs involved, and the transportation and handling and everything. But it's the solution for now, right? It's probably going to be a transition solution. We hope that at some point we'll be able to bunker directly, either compressed or liquid or whatever energy carrier it will be.
You're sidestepping that era by using containers.
Yeah, and it's really what now the inland sector, at least from the Netherlands and Germany, in this Rhine consortium that we have built with several skippers also, what we're looking at as the solution for now is to use those containers. It's really a way to overcome that hurdle.
Because there was a question from the audience. Do you see hydrogen-powered fuel cells as a viable option for seagoing vessels with a longer bunkering interval, for example, a week? if you're
sea going, yeah, short sea, we think it's possible, but a week is already pretty long. Mm-hmm. Depends on the operation, size of vessel, where it's sailing, how much time it's stopping in the port, whatever. You know, there's a whole operational profile behind it. But 3 days or so should be possible, especially if we go to liquid.
Yeah. Lennart, I have a dino blood question.
Oh.
A hydrogen-based synthetic diesel could compare with dino blood. However, however, it is expected to be very expensive to produce. Is it a viable competitor of hydrogen / fuel cells?
If you want to go to synthetic kerosene or synthetic diesel, you need CO2 from a non-fossil source. So you do to direct air capture, or you do CO2 from biomass, basically. And that's now really expensive because direct air capture is expensive, and there are not many so many sources where you can have extract CO2 from biomass. So I mean, but yeah, if you all develop that, then it can be an option. I mean, but not at the moment. But for long-term shipping, we have also ammonia or methanol. I mean, some big world players are setting up on ammonia. So I would say that that's a better option than going this route, I would say.
And probably it will exist next to each other. And there is probably also the aviation sector craving for dino blood alternatives. It is a competitor, but we've seen the market is huge. So they can probably coexist for a long time. Is that, do you agree?
Coexistence of many more technologies, what we will see in the future. And based on application and intended use, we will see the perfect technologies find their own places. Yeah. And I think it's quite difficult to do that today because we need so much more technological maturity also on these type of routes, and we will see where they end up. It's so difficult to predict that. But what we need is demonstrators.
Finish your sentence.
Yeah, I just wanted to add something to the story that you made about the business models and how to find the customer or the willingness to pay and how this is going to work. For years before this COVID crisis erupted, we were sponsoring the North Sea Hydrogen and Maritime Conferences, and we could see that waiting game. Every year when the drinks party is going on, you talk to the ports, they say, oh, I love this hydrogen stuff. I'm just waiting for those ship owner guys, right? And then the ship owner is saying, yeah, I love this stuff. I'm just waiting for
the right moment.
Yeah, for the shipyard to offer me this ship. And everybody is playing that waiting game. But then I spoke to one of these ministers of this Norwegian, infrastructure works, who are also tendering the ferries. He said it took me 12 years to get the first zero-emission ferry in the water. 4 months after that, it was passed in legislation that from there on, every new tender for ferries in Norway was supposed to be tendered on a zero-emission basis if possible. So I'm also quite confident
that the power of an example.
The power of an example.
That is what
we hope to achieve.
And I think Roel actually makes a fairly interesting point, because not only do you have the broad applicability of it, but actually, as you look at a lot of companies that are operating in the space and actually developing the technology, one, the access to capital is also a restricting factor, I think, in a number of cases. But every company seems to be at a different stage in the life cycle, and we're effectively dealing with a sector and a technology that's been around for a while. The commercial applicability has really only gathered steam in the last couple of years, and now you're seeing that across Europe, there's a whole sector that's evolving and looking for that opportunity to grow. Now, luckily, the backdrop to grow is phenomenal, but the challenges are that there's a lot of them at different stages in the cycle. Yep. So the financing side of it, and I'm glad to hear that the first ship's already there, but the financing side, you know, banks on the one hand, lending to a company without earnings or without cash flow is very challenging. The other side is trying to, from my personal perspective, trying to raise equity for those kind of companies is equally challenging. However, investors are increasingly moving down the risk curve towards that opportunity. And then you're identifying a completely a new universe of companies where I think the next sector leaders will come from, and the pioneers that will ultimately drive also consolidation in the sector in the next couple
of years. And we probably also need a lot of policy to make the leap over that maybe valley of death, or you know, get towards the light at the end of the tunnel. Yeah. Would be your recommendation in that regard?
Well, I think before I go there, I think it's quite interesting. We did a capital raise for a fuel cell company, a listed fuel cell company, 3-4 years ago now. And when we first took them on the road to meet with investors, a lot of the education was, I know what a fuel cell is, but tell me how is it applicable in the technology and how do you actually have the business model to scale up the production? I think Raul had mentioned also some of the challenges you have in actually making these fuel cells. So those are big education process required to ensure that not only did the product get the visibility, but also the companies in the space. We're now well and truly past that, and a lot of investors are now asking, well, what is it that makes this one different to the other one?
They know how it works.
They understand how it works. And in contrast to it being, yes, I've heard about this technology, but I don't believe it. The question now is, I believe in the technology. How can I actually ride that opportunity that comes out?
So the maturity and level of knowledge on the investor side, and in general, I think in the sector,
increased exponentially, absolutely. Yeah. And I think it's accelerated in particular in the last couple of years as sort of the traditional investment opportunities in the broader energy transition thematic have sort of, they're very widely available. I think returns have come down. They're maybe not as interesting as they are for different categories of investors. And so we're clearly seeing that knowledge there. And you've combined that with some of the framework that's coming. And I think what Raul and Marion have also mentioned in terms of the experience of operating in that sector, trying to actually apply that, actually creates quite an interesting point where we are in the cycle to bring the various parties together and make sure that this technology is at a critical stage and will continue to grow.
Because that's really, you know, bringing the people together is now the... They've worked on an island before, or...?
I think it's an opportunity, and I think that the big challenge is that it's such a fragmented market that trying to bring the various parties together is really the opportunity that we see. I mean, from my personal specific perspective, it's around the capital, but I think I hear similar stories from Raul and Marion and also Leonard on the technology side. You know, this is...
And once that happens...
Yeah. Then we can realize.
Basically, our aim is to get that first vessel sailing.
Yeah.
Just to make the point, it's possible to break that whole idea of it's not possible, it's not allowed, the regulations are not in place, you know, all this kind of and basically the only argument for cargo owners when we've proven that it's possible not to do it, so not to ship zero emission, is money. So that's going to be clear from that moment on. That's really the point I want to raise. Okay, it's possible. So the only reason you're not doing it, if you're sailing on inland vessels for now, is money.
And then the story towards policymakers is much more complete and much more directional in terms of what types of incentives you would need to bridge the gap.
Maybe you're not the only policymakers. We saw yesterday that also companies have a responsibility to not only look at what society is doing, but take a step further. Yeah. So maybe and the maritime sector is quite conservative, I think, but there's also a high level of competition. Yeah. So I don't know. Maybe looking at Abhinav, how are you like? I'll stimulate other clients actually to use new technologies or go to renewable fuels. I mean, that's another side. Besides stimulating technology, but also launching customers. Companies like, I think, Heineken, they are taking a step forward to use these new technologies. I don't know.
We have a big firm-wide initiative where we actually look at not just the energy transition sector, but also the other sectors. So you can, whether it can be mobility or technology or obviously some of the more traditional shipping sectors where the bank has historically had a large exposure, to really see what is the applicability and how can we actually help these companies in financing that whole business transformation that happens. Because where the model is currently at, in some cases, it's very obvious that there is a clear reason to do it from an economic perspective. In some cases, it's not quite there, but ensuring that you can actually get the financing and work with these companies, with these management teams, which are, again, at various stages in the cycle, to facilitate that process is one of the key parts that we're working on. And we have a dedicated energy transition team of 17 professionals across sectors working with corporates to try and facilitate that across not just the energy transition theme, but more broadly in the economy.
Yeah, this is exactly, I think, the sort of path we're trying to walk, not fall into the risk gap and try to take the opportunity. Cool. I forgot my train of thought. Rule. Would you be most interested to speak to a European policymaker or a Dutch policymaker?
That's a good question. A bit of both, I guess. And we do speak to both. We do speak to both.
And what are you telling them? What should they do?
I think to both we have the same message. One is about an energy transition. We shouldn't look at it as just an energy transition. As we see the policy moves in the rest of the world, they're considering the climate action to go hand in hand with this whole green jobs philosophy of replacing old industries with better ones, and that is something that we should not forget. We've been quite effective in installing wind turbines and solar fields and battery cars, but we forgot to keep the jobs that were with the battery technology. We were world leading on battery technology. We forgot about the jobs that come with PV installations, and we were world leading in that respect in the same way for turbines. I think the main message for those policymakers, and actually I have big respect for how they are picking up those messages, we should work climate action together with green jobs and green growth. Those things should go hand in hand. Europe has a perfect position. We've been investing so much in the fundamental research on fuel cell technology, demonstration, and now we're also still quite a leader when it comes to scaling up. Let's keep that, and let's keep that here. Don't forget about
the
green jobs.
On the hydrogen, on the fuel cell, and the entire ecosystem around it.
Yeah, right? We know that knowledge sticks to manufacturing. So when the manufacturing flees, so does the knowledge and the R&D and the expertise. Yeah. And it's very difficult to claim that back because, you know, these markets will institutionalize, supplier and customer relationships will condense. So you can only do that right once. And this is the time for us, for European and Dutch policymakers alike, to make sure that we coordinate adoption of technology also with the makership.
Yeah. That should be the end goal. Yep. One concrete policy proposal you would like to see introduced tomorrow.
Oh, wow, I didn't expect this question.
I can also go to Leonard first.
Go to Leonard.
I have so many things, but maybe one thing I had in mind. I mean, I think Europe could take technology leadership and give one example, which is an issue already in electric vehicles, is material scarcity. I mean, the sourcing of materials. And same with electrolyzer, they're using, and the fuel cells, using platinum, iridium. There's one country in the world, South Africa, where all the platinum is coming from.
Yeah.
I mean, just giving an example. So we need to go to improve the technology, use less of these scarce materials, so there's a good material agenda in Europe for to actually reduce and also the reliance of countries outside Europe, the environmental effects of the mining industry. I mean, this is just one example, but I mean, setting there the agenda, setting there the clear targets, I mean, that's really important.
Pushing adoption towards what is already there, but at the same time keep innovating and improving and going through the technological learning curve as we discussed.
Yeah.
Marion?
Yeah.
What for the shipping sector specifically, what will be needed tomorrow?
We need a clear pathway, right? So now targets have been more or less set, but they're still being adjusted once in a while. There are different targets between IMO, Europe, Netherlands. So it would be nice to have some alignment on those targets. And then as soon as possible, we would really like to, there should be a pathway. When can we sail, for example, with which type of vessel? When do we stop sailing on fossil fuel?
As soon as the mass vessel embarks on its first zero emission journey, maybe a mandate, no more new builds that are not zero emission for type X, Y, Z.
I would love to not see any internal combustion engines for fossil fuels anymore already, because why would we do that still? Yeah. Why would you now build a vessel inland? I think for deep sea it's still a little bit more complicated, but for some sectors you should just say stop.
Because it still be in the water by 2050 and beyond if you buy it.
So you always have to retrofit.
Yeah. Arthur?
Yeah, look, I think from the operational side, the guidelines and the framework, I think, is key. Where it sounds like, and certainly what we're hearing from the markets, is that the opportunity is very clearly there. What is really needed is the guidance and the support from the policy makers to ensure that the technology is developed. The capital is clearly there. And I think that is also, I think, the opportunity that we have to make sure that working with operators and other stakeholders within the sector to really bring that together.
Yeah. Mm. And if you would advocate for one specific policy measure?
I would focus for one specific
policy. You can also advocate for ones already mentioned.
I think what would really help is to see that at least within one of the forms of applicability, right, whether it's shipping or other subsectors, we've worked with companies that supply fuel cells for security operations or for construction operations, etc., that there is within one framework a clear guidance that says this, that highlights that this is a technology that you can work with and actually scale up and apply in a much broader range. So to take my own example, the one ship is great, but let's show that in the next 3 to 5 years, we're going from one ship to 10 to 20,
yeah.
And that there is that rule.
And then
you get the support and the build.
And then the capital will be there, rule to build 6 factories next to the current
one.
Right?
Why not? Yeah, I did some thinking, by the way. There's one point I wanted to make about what policy incentives or instruments you could use. And I think public procurement should not be underestimated. Yeah. We have no idea how much of a portion of our total economy goes through government. And if it's your policy...
Like public ferries that were mentioned earlier.
Yeah, the ferries. But think about wind parks that are being installed at sea. Yeah. This is still with maritime fuel oil, combustion. Yeah. Yeah. There are so many things that are directly or indirectly triggered and pulled and markets that are created by public procurement. Mm.
That's a perfect point to end this episode of Energy Transition Thursday, because we're out of time. There was a full hour on fuel cells. We hope you liked it. Next month, we're back. We're going to discuss solar energy 2.0. So solar energy has already gone through a full learning curve. But is now in a new phase, maybe subsidy-free and new types of application, floating. We're going to discuss all that on June 17th, again at 4 o'clock. So hope to see you then, and hope you speak Dutch, because that episode will be in Dutch. Goodbye.